You've just been told you're going to spend the next 5 years of your life incarcerated, and your sentence will be served at a penal colony called Devil's Island. You think that's not the best sounding name, but then you remember deviled eggs are mighty tasty, and your mom used to call you a little devil, so maybe Devil's Island is a term of endearment. Maybe not. Because on your way over there, a guy next to you, also wearing those fashionable shackles, tells you that 3/4 of people that go here don't come back. "What do you mean?" you ask. "What do you think?" he replies. "It's hell on earth. You go in and you die." "Sacre bleu," you think, because you're actually French and you don't usually say things like "holy moly." You have to escape, but as you'll soon find out, that's going to be very, very hard. The reason it's going to be hard is because you'll be staying in an almost deserted island. In fact, when you get there, you're quite surprised that you're actually allowed to roam about a bit. You even get to sleep in a large room with other guys. The downside is that most of them are killers. It's true that many men that go in don't come out, and just after you got there, you saw dead fellas being carried on stretchers. You try and formulate an escape plan, but seeing as you're stuck on an island off the coast of South America, getting back to Paris could be just a little bit difficult. But one day you hear whispers from other prisoners. They tell tales of amazing escapes. "I'll go down in convict history too," you think. Just wait and see. You know you're on an island that's part of the Salvation Islands. You know that you're in the Atlantic Ocean, about 9 miles from the nearest inhabited spot in French Guiana. So that will be your first stop on your escape route. It's time to eat, and you find out the daily rations consist of a plate of thin soup, one solitary vegetable, 1 kilogram of bread, and 250 grams of meat, which isn't a lot once it's been cooked. It's enough to survive on, though, until you get out. Okay, so time to get the lowdown on this place, and luckily you meet a guy who's part of the 25%. He's been on Devil's Island since 1938, so that's 6 years, and he's still not dead. His name is Jean-Paul, and he's a convicted murderer, you hear. But after killing, his other hobby was studying history. He knows everything about Devil's Island and other French penal colonies. He sleeps in the same block as you, so you have time to chat with him. Both of you take a seat, and you tell him you want to have a history lesson. "Okay, Victor," he says, "how can I expand the mind of a man from a Parisian slum? What do you want to know?" "Everything," you reply excitedly, although you don't like the tone of his voice. He tells you that you're staying on a very small island. It's only about 34 acres in size, and so to get from one side to the other isn't exactly a long walk. You'll notice that the prison walls aren't so high, and Jean-Paul sees the hopefulness written on your face. He reminds you that much of the time you're in chains, and then informs you the water is shark-infested. He also says that if you get caught trying to escape, then you're just not beaten to death by the guards. What awaits you is a special kind of hell. He says he'll get to that, but first, a bit of history. Jean-Paul tells you that in the 17th century, if you committed a heinous crime, you might be sentenced to be an oarsman on a French Mediterranean galley ship. This was basically slavery, and virtually all men would row until they died. "Row till you go" is what all the convicts called it. This is supposed to make you feel better, you assume. He says that after the galley fleet was retired, the men would work as prisoners in the docks, but some were sent to far-off islands. The islands were no paradise, because the guys were pretty much stranded. They might starve to death out there, and so it was much better life working on the docks. At least there, you had a prayer. Jean-Paul tells you that in 1832, the French government did at least create some laws that ensured that prisoners at least got the basic stuff they needed to survive. You know, like a bit of food and water. He explains that with all the crime in France and the fact that some men just couldn't be rehabilitated in French prisons, the idea for penal colonies on French-owned islands really took off. In the 1850s, French Guiana was chosen as the spot for penal colonies. Then in 1854, Napoleon III sent around 80,000 people to the islands of Isle Royale, Isle St. Joseph, and as well as the one you're sitting on. What were they doing time for, you ask? He tells you severe civil crimes, but also political crimes. Get caught spying or just become an enemy of the state in the eyes of the government, and you're virtually guaranteed to make a trip to one of those islands. He says that you're fortunate in many ways, and he then explains why. First, you get quite a few breaks from the pointless labor you're doing, and that's because so many men just die doing that job. Right now, the French government is not so harsh. He says there's a good reason the transportation to a penal colony is called the dry guillotine. "You're actually lucky to even have made it here in one piece," he says. "Why's that?" you respond, now feeling a little bit irked. He keeps calling you lucky. "I'm wearing shackles," you think, but you hold back the urge to say anything. You need this information for your escape. He tells you that a lot of men die on the prison ships coming here. The food isn't exactly plentiful, but some guys just pass out and die in those dingy cages. Well, not some, quite a lot, actually. You remember your journey on the prison ship. It was pretty horrible, and you didn't much like being told your name was now not Victor, but Prisoner 69664. Maybe you got a better ship than the other men. Jean-Paul says that since there was always a chance of mutiny and the sailors on the ship being killed by vagabonds and dissidents, they take a hard line on acting out. On his ship, men were scalded with hot steam just for complaining. He says one time the guys started singing and the guards didn't much like the outbreak of joviality. They locked the doors and threw sulfur sticks next to the cells. The men almost choked to death. "Merde," you mutter. "Right," he says, and carries on with his morbid history lesson. "The thing is, most men that come here will never make it back to France. It's not because everyone gets beat by the guards, but if you're seen as out of line, they'll just make sure you starve to death. Okay, so your family back home might send you food and clothing, but the guards will take their cut from that stuff. And if you annoy them enough, they'll give you nothing. There's a saying we convicts have here, and that's that the guards come with one trunk of stuff and leave with six. Not much gets to the prisoners. People just die from starvation at times." This makes you want to leave more, and then he tells you that the mosquitoes carry disease, and many prisoners contract one of the various tropical diseases, and that kills them. Even if you have the right nutrients to survive, there are many other ways to die. Another reason you might have a prolonged stay is the fact that some guys just get sentenced to forced residence. Funny, you've never heard of that. Jean-Paul tells you that some convicts will finish their sentence and become guards, a practice known as doublage. You'd think that with all they'd been through, those guys would actually be sympathetic, he says, but they're actually the biggest jerks. Others you hear just have a stay on the island, not as prisoners, but as residents. They get a bit of land and a house, but that doesn't exactly save them from tropical diseases. France doesn't want them. They become exiles indefinitely, says Jean-Paul. Another problem, he says, is revolt. He tells you about the revolt on the Isle of St. Joseph in 1894 when some guys hacked four guards to death. The convicts didn't even get off the island. The infantry arrived the next day and killed them. He said this place is full of thugs and bandits and they'll kill you as soon as look at you. They'll sneak up to your bed at night and slit your throat if you have something they want. "I don't see any graves," you tell Jean-Paul, saying that with just a hint of suspicion in your voice. Maybe Devil's Island isn't as bad as he's making out. "That's because when you die, and I assure you, many will die while you're here, they take the guy to the edge of that cliff over there, dump him in the ocean. It's basically feeding time for the sharks, and that's one reason they like to hang around this island. We've become a really convenient cafe for those sharks. If they could speak, they'd be saying, 'Thank God for crime.' There's a saying around here along the lines of, 'For every criminal's misery, someone or something is benefiting.'" Jean-Paul is turning out to be so depressing, and he notices your downtrodden expression and seems to enjoy it. "Oh, I haven't told you about solitary confinement yet. Oh God, there was a guy in here by the name of Henri Charrière. We just called him Papillon. This guy was an escape master, but every time he got off a penal colony, he ended up getting caught again. They finally sent him out here because Devil's Island is the one place no one can escape from. Well, that's what they thought. They threw Papillon in solitary for 2 whole years. He told me he suffered more than you can imagine. Every day in one tiny cement cell with hardly any food. Every day in almost pitch black darkness, holed in. The place filled with the dangerous insects at times. Centipedes crawling over his face, snakes slithering under the door, ants biting the hell out of him. He said when the warden threw him in there, he said, 'Papillon, the best you can hope for now is starvation.' Jesus. Yep, that's solitary on Devil's Island. You couldn't come up with a worse nightmare if you tried. How Papillon didn't die of starvation or disease is nothing short of a miracle." What? He survived? Not only survived, one day he was just gone. Maybe they killed him. Nope. Word got around that Papillon had left the chat. He was off the island, gone. I'd heard he'd made a raft out of coconuts. That's it, you think, and start looking around for coconuts. You just know he's about to tell you something bad to bring you down. Jean-Paul tells you that after Papillon's escape, the guards have become paranoid. If they even get a whiff that you want to escape, they'll break your bones and you'll wish you'd never dreamed of freedom. He tells you that some men got badly beaten for walking slowly and limping after a beating. He saw a warden shoot a man dead just because the man said he was tired and then refused to cut down some trees to make a clearing. "Huh, well, they've been okay with me so far," you tell him. "Really?" he says. "I've been beaten lots of times. They left you alone, eh? You don't know how lucky—" I know, stop telling me that." He shoots you a peeved expression but carries on with his story. "There are people who have been here that have done nothing wrong," he tells you, saying that a French army captain named Alfred Dreyfus was at the heart of a massive scandal in France, and while totally innocent, he was convicted of treason. Since they really didn't want this guy getting out and talking about corruption, sometimes they kept him in the hole and other times they just chained him to his bed. He was a really smart guy and once told someone that on this island people were no longer human. They were cut off from the land of the living. What happened to him? He tells you that this whole affair became huge in France, although you've never heard of it. It doesn't help that you can't read. Anyway, Jean-Paul tells you that this guy was eventually found innocent in a retrial. He tells you that just before he arrived on the island, someone wrote a book about Dreyfus's experience. He let the world know about the dry guillotine. "There are rumors that they'll stop with this penal colony thing soon," says Jean-Paul. "People in France couldn't believe how we were treated here when they heard the stories. You didn't hear about it because I'm assuming you can't read." Typical, you think. People only take notice when an educated man with wealth suffers. If you told people back home about injustice, they'd make a comic strip out of it. Your spirits lift when Jean-Paul tells you another guy escaped from the island and made his way to New York. He also wrote a book about it called Revolt. That guy was an anarchist, you hear. Another guy wrote a book while actually on the island, he tells you, and he managed to get that manuscript across the ocean on his escape. He tells you about 100 convicts have escaped from all penal colonies. "No way," you say, feeling really optimistic now. Then he tells you that many just ended up dying somewhere in the Guinean tropical forest. Some were killed by local tribes, others just perished of disease or starvation. This guy is such a downer, you think, and tell him to tell you more about the writer escapee. "We wrapped that manuscript in oilskins to protect it from the water and rain and took it all the way to California. I read it just before they sent me here. It's called Dry Guillotine, 15 Years Among the Living Dead." "Wow," you say and ask, even though you know, "what is it again that you did to get sent here?" "I killed my wife," he says. "Why?" you ask, aware that you probably shouldn't be doing that. Jean-Paul replies, "She called me condescending." "How surprising," you say. "Yeah," he replies, "that woman didn't know how good she had it." After learning how you would never escape Devil's Island, you might want to know about some of the greatest prison escapes ever. And fortunately, we've told the story, so have a look at these. World War II prisoner escapes through toilet, and the most insane ways men escaped from prison.